Welcome back after the break. Hope you all will be enjoying the session now as we have two exciting sessions left with us. Very first, calling upon the chairperson for the session, Dr. Chandrakant Deoram Bagal sir, assistant professor at Department of Chemistry at Pune College of Pharmacy, Bharatiya Vidyapeeth University. Sir has a teaching experience of 2 years and a research experience of 5 years. He has contributed for 19 international publications and has participated in many national and international conferences and workshops. We cordially welcome you, sir. Handing over the platform to you.
Okay. Thank you, Kritika. Hello all. I would like to introduce today's speaker, Professor Sunita Pawar. Professor Sunita Pawar has completed his postgraduate from the KLE College of Pharmacy and currently pursuing PhD from the Pune College of Pharmacy, Bharatiya Vidyapeeth University, Pune. She is working as an assistant professor in Department of Clinical Pharmacy since 8 years and guiding students in various sectors like adverse drug reaction in pediatric oncology, medication error, pharmacovigilance, lifestyle disease, and rational prescription, and so on. She has published more than 23 national and international papers, which securing the best paper award at Oncology International Conference 2017. She has also received the best poster award at ABMH Pune Pharmacon Conference 2018. She has total 6 years of experience at Quintin India Limited, Mumbai as a senior clinical research associate and carried out phase 4 study in infectious disease. Also, Professor Sunita Pawar has trained practice in pharmacy, community and hospital, and various technical aspects like pharmaceutical care services, patient counseling, asthma, self-medication, cholesterol, storage condition, hypertension, diabetes, clinical pharmacy, and skills, etc., in collaboration with MSPC, IPF, Pfizer Academia. She has participated in over 10 workshops on health skills through pharmacy practice, pharmacovigilance, and medication safety, emerging trends in phytochemistry and biotechnology. Pharmacy review on for clinical pharmacy practice and so on. So Professor Sunita has conducted and organized more than 10 workshops in community activities for learning and pharmacy practice. So with this introduction, I will hand over this session to Professor Sunita Pawar.
Thank you, Dr. Bagal. Thank you very much for such a wonderful introduction of mine. And hopefully maximum of us, we have joined here for this session. And I can understand that post-launch, how difficult it is. So what I have thought of, like, before I start with my session today, why not all of us undergo a very small and a brief and a very crisp exercise wherein it is related with my topic, that is medication errors. So I'm sharing one link with you all, and I'm going to give you 3 minutes of time within which you have to submit your responses in the form of Google Forms. There are 5 questions. Take your time, but after 3 minutes, the responses will be totally stopped. So I'm sharing with you all. This is like a pre-session and a post-session, this questionnaire would be. So please attempt this, and post-session also, I'm going to circulate one questionnaire to you all. Hardly 5 questions are there, and I'll also be sharing with you all responses maybe today or maybe later. So I'm just sending you all, please attempt it as early as possible. How do we do this? Yeah, I have sent, kindly attempt this questionnaire. And I'm going to count exactly 3 minutes. That is by 2:08, this link will be, the responses will be stopped for us. All of you, please attempt it. Ayush, am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. So once I receive the responses, Ayush, then I'll be, you know, sharing my
PPT. No problem, ma'am. No problem.
Yeah. All the students are also requested to do the same thing, that they are supposed to also attempt it along with the delegates. Last 1 minute is remaining, then I'll be closing the link and the responses for this. Yes, the time is over for the responses, and let us start with the, you know, topic, today's topic. Is the screen visible to all?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, perfect. So today's topic for me to present is medication error or safety concern and measures to prevent them. So this particular typical subject or a topic, first of all, will be, you know, very much, you know, understood and perceived if, like, we all of us actually know the terms very, very clearly. And hopefully every one of us, we are aware of it. But let us just go through and refresh ourselves exactly what these terms mean. And very much till now, you all must have, you know, heard of it and gone through it. Like every talk now and then, everybody has introduced this term or related or correlated this term somewhere with the safety. And definitely it is a big concern as far as the safety is related. So let us understand, like, how any best we can prevent it. So this slide itself, you know, is a little bit presenting itself in a very, very layman's norm, that how, like, oh, did I do that? Yeah, definitely. I know there has an error which has happened. And then I am a little confused whether I did it or not. I'm talking about I means, like, these are all the stakeholders of healthcare providers who are somewhere or the other, in some or the other way, related to the patient care. Fine. So some, like, from this particular, like, whatever, like, doubt what we have, we arrive at the definition of medication errors or a medical errors. So normally we all know that, I don't have to say this again, but then I'm just re-emphasizing it. What is the purpose of oral therapy? It is to achieve the therapeutic outcomes with minimum patient risk. And in addition to that, if we talk about pharmaceutical care, also the patient outcome, that is a positive outcome, is, you know, actually expected with the best quality of life. This is an additional definition to this. So is it possible that in every environment, and we will get this? Yeah, definitely it is possible, provided we all are very, very careful and prevent all possible types of errors or mishaps. So let us understand what exactly this error we mean by, and what is the difference between when we say, oh, I made a mistake, or when we say, or sometimes we may not say that I made an error. Because what is an error? Like, it is an error, it is an act that fails to achieve or depart from what should be done, either due to the following, either due to ignorance, due to deficiency, or by accident or accidental happening it is. So I'm not aware. Many a times I'm not aware that I've committed an error, right? So it may be merely because of all these, you know, processes, like it may happen so. But can we afford to do it? Definitely not. Yeah, and the mistakes, what are mistakes? Mistakes in prior only. We know that the mistakes are something which is very, very wrong, or something very, it is very harmful. But then mistakes are like, it can happen accidentally always. Fine. But if we do the mistakes again and again, it may become intentional. Whereas in the errors, which are, you know, we are seeing here or going to see in thoroughly, that errors may be always, or are always rather, unintentional. So that is the difference between a mistake and an error. So if you take the terminology, that is medication error, and you, if you like want to know the standard definition, and this particular definition, it has been, you know, provided by actually WHO. Now this, just a moment, I'll just make it a slideshow. Yeah. So can you see this? This like a slide, I've just made it a little bigger and a slideshow so that it is more visible. So medication error, if you were to see the standard definition as per WHO, it is any preventable event, preventable, mind this word, this is a preventable event that may cause or lead to inappropriate medication use or patient harm while the medication is in the control of the healthcare professional, the patient, or the consumers. So it is quite possible. Now, medication errors are of many types, which we'll be seeing in the future slides, but these are very much, very much preventable. We may not allow this to reach the patient. If we do so, then the patient may not be harmed at all. So that is what we have to know. But first of all, we need to know various sources, various processes, various kinds and the types, like how it occurs, because many a times we are ignorant about it. So such events may be related to so many following processes which occur across or in a healthcare setup and around the patient. So what are these events? They, like, these are quite related with, these errors are related with the professional practices, the directly with the healthcare products, procedures and systems, product labeling, packaging, nomenclatures, the dispensing process, the distribution process, administration process, the amount and the extent of education to the healthcare providers and even the patient, and the monitoring of the patient. So many aspects are there, and anywhere and due to any deficiency of these processes, the medication error can happen. Now, before I go into the details of technicality, just see this slide. This is kind of an advertisement, which I got it from the web itself. Like, wherein it talks about, or it is advertising that, hey, look, like if you want to go from one place to the other, I have a lot of airlines. I have a lot of jets with me. This is an airline which is announcing it. And it says that, like, every day, 1 to 2 jets are, you know, are like quite likely to crash. And the outcome is what? If we just calculate the outcome, and at the end of the week, we see that around this particular airline, it has got over 1,000 deaths because of its crashes every week. What it means, even though if I provide a lot of good facilities and n number of, or a good amount of whatever products which I have, but if with that there are these mishaps which are associated, do you think that patient will be very, very eager to take his or her medicine? Or in this case, will I be so much eager and will be very happy to, you know, take up this particular jet to travel? Definitely not. In spite of providing with all the wonderful facility and making me reach my destination easily, I'm not going to opt for such a thing. So it is quite equivalent. If you got to see, this is a US-based data from a particular study by Cohen et al. It talks about that around 44,000 to 98 deaths annually occur due to medical errors, right? It is quite equivalent to the incident which we saw in the previous slide. Do you think that if the patient comes to know, reads this, that you can, like, or there can be a death related to medication and due to medication, especially medication errors which are committed or omitted by somebody, right? So this is definitely not going to attract me to, you know, take up the medicines. Rather, I'll be reluctant to do so. If you got to see the extent to which any medical error, they can cause the mortality, it places it to the sixth position. If you compare it with a very, very high end, very, very complex disease related, whatever mishaps or medication error or like whatever mishaps may occur, like, and cause the mortality, you know, the disease per se, the, in that list, if you play, try to place this medical error related deaths, then it puts it to the sixth position. So, and which is very, very critical. That's why it's a one of the utmost topic to be, you know, taken care of and looked into and be vigilant about and reported. So if you got to see cardiovascular, cancer, stroke, lung accidents, they actually lead to about in thousands and lakhs the deaths annually. And even medical errors, more than 1 lakh deaths annually it leads to. This is what the data is, that it is well studied data and it has been declared in January 2012. And rest of those are following. Even the diabetes like diseases are causing, you know, deaths nowadays. So overall, a medication error, it is an error of commission or omission at any step along the path that begins. It has got a journey in itself. Like, we have to see from where it starts. So it starts actually in practice when a clinician is prescribing, and when it actually reaches the patient, patient takes it either in the hospital setup or at the OPD basis, he goes home and takes it. So this entire journey, okay, fine, right from the beginning, from where it has been, you know, actually prescribed, and it reaches the patient, and then it starts showing the effects on the patient. In this entire process, be it personal or the system based, anywhere anything goes wrong or it goes haywire, right, then it is definitely going to lead to harm to the patient. So it is utmost important that we need to understand even these processes, these systems, or the causalities which lead to medication error. Now, before to that, like, we need to understand few other terms very well and see to it, like, how it is correlated or it leads to. So first of all, we have to note, as we are talking about the safety, so definitely the pharmacovigilance part, this is part and parcel of pharmacovigilance, and it affects the pharmacovigilance directly. So like this particular term, if you got to see an adverse event, right, adverse drug event rather, It is defined as a harm experienced by a patient as a result of exposure to any medication. Now, these adverse event doesn't talk, like, it may not always happen that it may happen directly with or due to the drug. Fine. It can also happen like due to any errors, and that process leading to some outcome, some kind of outcomes in the patient which are not acceptable. So as with the more general term adverse event, the occurrence of adverse drug event does not necessarily indicate an error or a poor quality of care, not always. Fine. Now, adverse event, it is a word which has got an wholesome umbrella of events, which is, you know, which it actually encompasses. So there can be an adverse drug reactions, there can be SAEs under it, there can be SUSARs in this. So it covers a lot, many things in it. So ADA, that difference between these two processes are like, these two terminologies are, is that, like, when we say that ADR, we know that there is a direct causality at a very normal and a standard dosages and the intention at which the drugs have been used. But sometimes you do not know about AD. AD may happen. There are so many other, in the form of signs, symptoms, events, or processes, it may occur in a patient which are not acceptable. But just because that patient is on that medication, we can correlate that maybe because of this medicine, this is happening. But it can be in the form of, you know, lab changes. It can be any form of any other accidents. It can be form of like some other prognosis happening with the drug. The outcomes may be in the form of sometimes like events like prolongation of the hospitalization stay of the patient. Then there can be a congenital anomaly. There can be a very life-threatening event followed to actual the treatment or the sequel to the disease itself. So events can be in the form of, you know, so many other types of like happenings to the patient just because he's taking the medicine. So, but not always that medication error may lead to AD. That we need to understand, right? So we know we don't have to say much, but then like we don't have to like this is self-understood outcomes related to medication errors, that it may increase morbidity, mortality, prolongation of the hospital, increases treatment cost, and also results in wastage of valuable resources. Now imagine valuable resources, though I have not quoted over here, but if we got to see in like the way we saw that, like the entire chain or a cycle is that right from the patient, you know, being prescribed by the doctor until such time he is taking it. Even this process is even ahead of this these events. That is like right from when the, if you got to see like how it will be a waste, a single dose, like a unit of medicine, if you got to take, we all know that like how much efforts it takes from right from drug discovery and development, its design, its testings, animal studies, preclinical, then it comes to clinical, and then it reaches the patient. By then the sponsor has invested so much of or so many resources, expertise, time, expenses, and then it is coming to the patient. So imagine if there are any problems in this process or anywhere, or any personnel is making any mistakes or committing any errors, this entire process of so many efforts, we are actually making it a failure. So totally all the resources, not only like when the patient is taking the medicines, like after the doctor has prescribed, but it is right from the beginning itself. So we have wasted the entire expertise, efforts of everyone in this particular process. It means that wastages. So we definitely need to be preventing it and be very, very vigilant about it. Then medication errors remain unreported due to so many problems, which is actually in practice is being seen and felt and experienced by all of us because we are actually working in the hospital setup. So we come to know and we see this on day-to-day basis. So that is the biggest barrier, you can say, or a bottleneck where an underreporting is there of these medication errors, and actually which needs to be, it should be a part and parcel of mandatory reporting the way we do for pharmacovigilance. But pharmacovigilance, what we are doing? Pharmacovigilance we are doing when the drug is causing something wrong to the patient. So by then it has already reached the patient and caused almost whatever possible harm it could have been. But in medication error, there is definitely a scope and a chance we can, if we identify it well in advance, and we can definitely allow it to be preventable, as we can make it preventable, and we won't allow it to reach to the patient. So there can be no harms caused and no other wastages or any kind of problems which may occur subsequent to this. So there are so many aspects like we need to look into, like the why people don't actually talk about medical errors or report. Like first of all, there is a fear of litigation. Definitely they feel, or a doctor, especially I'm talking about from the doctor's point of view, who is the prescriber. He must have written, though medical errors are always defined with a word called as unintentional. So nobody would be doing it intentionally. That will be totally illegal, unethical, that we know that, and nobody practices such things. There can be some other mishaps, omissions and commissions, which we don't come to know, but nobody will do it intentionally, that is for sure. But in spite of all this, we know that like since I have written and I have made a mistake, it has reached the patient and the harm has been caused, or there was a potential to harm. Maybe it is critical harm, maybe less serious, moderate harm, or whatever kind of harm it is. But then it is very, very serious. So in that case, like people are very, very fearful to actually report it or even say it to anybody. And people try to hide this. That is one problem. Then apart from that, fear of harming their own reputation, definitely it is there. Everybody thinks I may lose my job. I may be called as a bad doctor or a bad practitioner, and people may not come to me, or I will not be recommended to patients. Fear of harming the doctor's relationship with the healthcare institute, the same thing it involves. So there are so many fears and likes of legality and the reputation, the image, and like personal fears. So that leads to underreporting or non-reporting of such events. Now, if you got to see the categories, like there are almost like well-defined 9 categories. And all these 9 categories of medication errors, they are again subdivided, accumulated as per the 4 outcomes. Like if you see this particular image or the classification, it is well directly it is reflecting like what how it is subcategorized as. So if you got to see from A to I, there are 9 categories of different types of medication errors. So in category, if you see the coloration, and here these are the outcomes. So each outcome is constituting either a single type of event or it is a combination of 3 to 4 events. So in the first category, if you got to see the blue category is the single wholesome of it, and then it is category A, wherein the circumstances or events constitutes of any circumstances or events that have the capacity to cause error. Means there was a potential to cause error, but it did not happen. Fine, but there is a potential, and if any mistakes are done or errors are committed here, definitely it may cause harm to the patient. It will reach to the patient and it will cause harm to the patient. Now there is something called as a category B, wherein an error occurred, but the error did not reach the patient. So error, somebody has made the error. Say for example, the nurse made some error, that wherein she picked up the wrong medicine and she was about to administer it to the patient, but then she realized well in time and she did not give the medicine to the patient. So the error did not reach the patient. So that is a B category. Then if you got to see category C, wherein an error occurred that reached the patient but did not cause any potential harms. So already reached, the nurse gave the patient and it caused the error. It got administered to the patient, but it did not show any clinical signs or symptoms or any harm, outcomes in the patient. Then apart from this, then there is another category, category D, wherein an error occurred that reached the patient and required monitoring to confirm that it resulted in no harm to the patient or required intervention to preclude the harm. So in this particular category, if you got to see, of B and C, if you compare, this was of little concern. This was a risky medication error which reached to the patient and definitely needed an observation and monitoring and also sometimes the intervention so that the patient is not harmed. Then it comes as you go on in this particular cycle, you will see that intensity and the whatever the causality related to medication error, it is increasing. So if you arrive at category E, it talks about an error that occurred that may have contributed or resulted in temporary harm to the patient and definitely required intervention. So temporary harm means definitely there would have been a sequel and there would have been harm. Either he would have had to be admitted in the hospital and taken care of and given treatment. Then there is a category F, an error occurred that may have contributed or resulted in temporary harm to the patient and required initial or prolonged hospitalization. So definitely harm has been caused over here and then patient has been hospitalized for a longer period of time. So, and next to this is category G, where an error occurred that may have contributed to or resulted in a permanent patient harm, which is irreparable. Fine. So it could have been of that category wherein it is irreparable and it cannot be reversed back. Fine. And there could have, say for example, there is a pregnant lady and there has been a administration by mistake to her a category X type of a drug, which is totally contraindicated in the pregnancy. And it would lead to definitely a congenital anomaly when the baby is born. So that is a permanent type of a problem. Then there is something called as a category H, where an error occurred that required intervention necessary to sustain the life. So it was a life-threatening kind of a serious adverse problem wherein intervention had to be done to save the patient's life itself. So you got to see that the intensity is increasing. It is arriving at the death or it is arriving at the life-saving interventions. Now last category, which is shown in the green, is the wholesome. It talks about the death. So there was such a kind of an error which actually resulted in the death of the patient. So this is merely just because of medication errors. So see the grievance and see the very harmful outcomes which are likely to be there once the medication errors are committed. So we need to be, that's why very, very careful. if you got to see, there are so many factors, like so many manufacturing related or labeling related factors. If you got to see, there is a particular company you work, these two products, they belong to both Ranbaxy. One is a Cipro, one is a clarithromycin, both being antibiotic. But there are specific usages and indications. And as per the protocol and the guidelines, they have to be given in a particular condition only. But if you got to see, if these two look so similar, fine. Though they may not be they little bit sound alike, but then they are looking so similar, wherein their strength wise, color wise, their size wise, if you go to say container wise, they both look very alike. And suppose there is a pharmacist who has to, in a very hurry and a pressurized condition, has to dispense. If somebody comes and there is a lot of workload on him and he has to give in a hurry medication, it's quite likely, instead of, you know, being Cipro being prescribed, he may give clarithromycin. It can lead to suboptimal therapy. It can lead to unnecessary exposure towards antibiotics and will be causing the, you know, resistance. We all know that. So look alike medications are visually similar in physical appearance of packing. So there is a, right from the manufacturing problem till the labeling problem, till the storage problem or stacking problem. And then it may lead to even process problem it may lead to. Ultimately, the pharmacist may pick up a wrong bottle or a wrong antibiotic altogether, which has been prescribed otherwise. Now, manufacturing strategies to avoid errors due to look-alike drugs. So what can be done in such a situation? Like if you got to see, like the company, like one of the company, if it is its product, wherein it has got four strengths, 10 mg, 20 mg, 30 mg, 40 mg of the same product, and it has got a similar labeling strategy, if you go to see, it can be made very prominent. It can be made very, very demarcated by color coding itself. So if you go to see the color coding and even the highlighting of the strengths can help any pharmacist or the while dispensing to actually identify the very correct medicines while dispensing. Fine. And then if you got to see here, now this is again, like if you, these are injectables, right? Now unsafe and safer design of the injection ampule boxes. If you got to see, now they also look like they can be made very prominent by relabeling them or emphasizing on the kind of labeling it already has. Like if you got to see, either you write by generic name, or you write by proprietary name. If you got to see here, this is a very clear if you see this label, if you compare with this particular label, this can lead to ambiguity many a times, can confuse the pharmacist. Okay, and further administration also may get hampered. If you give a very clear cut labeling effects, like generics are very prominently written, though, then the chances brands can cause a lot of look alike or seem alike type of a drug. So it can cause confusion. But if you write by generic, it gives you a very good indication that what drug it is or medication it is. There is a clear cut dosing which has been, you know, highlighted very well, and what purpose it is used for IV use. So if it is for IV use, then it will be given at rightly. It will be chosen, selected, and given by the correct route. If not, and this is hidden, if you got to see in this particular label, it's written very, very, in a very, very small abbreviations. So here the pharmacist can get confused and may, instead of IV, it may, you know, give otherwise in some, by some other route. So it may happen with respect to the nurses who actually administer the medicines. So these are few examples. Again, in this table, if you go to see names of few medications that have the spelling similarities which are there and which can definitely cause problems. So there can be a similar spelling and phonetics, which may lead to, again, in spite of doctor being has written the correct order, the pharmacist can, you know, misidentify it and can give altogether a different medication while dispensing. So you've got to see, these are the brands which actually cause a lot of confusion, and phonetics are quite similar and they sound alike. Generics, actually, if you got to see, they are totally poles apart. If you see the constituents and the indications are also totally different. But there are chances of interchange and exchanges would be there while dispensing very much. It is quite possible. Or even nurses reading, you know, in that way and giving that type of medicine. But here, the dispensing errors, it would lead to highest level if this is the scenario. So clinical users, if you were to see, these are totally different altogether. Like if you go to one is a serratiopeptidase, another is a haloperidol, antipsychotic and proteolytic enzymes. Together, totally, they are meant for two different indications altogether. So this can lead to very major outcomes and harmful outcomes rather than actually what is to be treated for. So only like this can be, pharmacists can be told not to keep all these Lazar type of drugs together. It should be well labeled properly, properly labeled and demarcated and differentiated in storages altogether in different racks. And then he can label it also those racks, and as well as relabeling can be done on that just to avoid the pickup of a wrong medicine while dispensing. Illegible prescription, we don't have to say much about it. We all know that how it may lead to the errors itself. Some like we cannot first of all understand. And if Laza and type of drugs which are already available, and so many of them are there and of the same company, then definitely a spelling, a single spelling or a misinterpreted spelling is definitely going to lead to picking up of the wrong medicine in dispensing. Apart from this, there are such, some of the very dangerous events as well, that is called, those are called as near miss events, which are like an unplanned event that did not result in injury, illness or damage, but had the potential to do so. And that's why it is called as a near miss event. So like by chance or by luck, we would say that the omission or commission was made, but it did not reach the patient or cause any harm to the patient. So such events are, they fall under the category of near miss events. Now, type of errors based on various parameters are also demarcated, and we should know about it, why it happens. Like there is a knowledge-based error, there can be a rule-based error, there can be an action-based error, there can be a technical error, or there can be a memory-based error. So examples already are given here. I'll not cover all, but just you can go through and see like which all are these. Like one of this, let us pick up like knowledge-based, if you want to see. Being unaware of the interaction between warfarin and erythromycin, it is never ever given. Fine, this type, it has got a lot of these two have the lot of potentials, and it leads ultimately to the warfarin toxicity. And we know that warfarin toxicity, then totally there will be a lot of bleedings in a patient. There are such some patients who are already prone towards, or they are into like such health conditions wherein the you cannot afford to have bleeding, may lead to strokes, hemorrhages, and those further complications. So like we really need to be quite aware, or should be knowledgeable and should be updated with regards to each medication profile. If not, then this would definitely lead to problems and errors in this fashion. Then some other errors, like rule-based errors may be there, like prescribing oral treatment and a patient who's dysphagic. Fine, if you give to the patient when already his tract, like is the oral tract is, you know, dysphagic, has got a lot of pain or swelling or some kind of inflammation. And if you try to give some by that route, any oral medications which are of bigger size, okay, or even to geriatric or pediatrics may happen. So lung, it could lead to lung aspirations. Fine, and suboptimal treatment. Apart from this, then there can be an action-based errors wherein being distracted while dispensing. If there is a such a kind of outlet wherein it is near the road and a lot of traffic is going on, you're distracting it, or a lot of work pressure is there when everybody is like on your this you're pressurizing, or even you're getting calls from somewhere and simultaneously you're dispensing. Definitely in such an environment, the person who is actually picking up and giving is going to get distracted. Not only the pharmacist, but even in the clinical wards wherein the nurses are handling patients, there also if you try to distract them and while they are actually selecting the medication or preparing the medication for the patient and going to administer them, if you try to distract them, distraction can be in the form of so many physical forms as well. There can be distraction due to noises, there can be distraction due to a lot of pressurization, workload, and there can be due to like the nurses doing continuously one after the other the shifts, there is a very low light, no brightness is there, the environment is very, very very, very depressive type of an environment wherein it can also cause the effect on the actions of certain people. So instead of dispensing diazepam, the pharmacist would go and just pick up diltiazem, by mistake and would give it, and it will ultimately lead to sedation. It is not affordable in certain category of patients like geriatrics and all. You cannot. It may lead to further falls in that and accidents for them. So like one hour after the other, the complications may be, you know, arise. So that's why action-based even errors are can be there. So these are so many different factors leading to all various types of errors. Technical, it can be technicality in illegible writing and all that. Like that, that is a very common thing from the prescriber itself. Then memory-based, like forgetting to specify maximum daily dose. Poisoning or unnecessary treatment may occur. Fine, so maximum daily dose, that's why the doctor, like the prescriber, has to have a good memory, has to have a good knowledge base, has to be very vigilant while he's writing, like what amount and type and the frequency, because otherwise itself it will be causing a lot of over-treatment and toxicities. Then there are, apart from this, various factors which actually influence or lead to medication errors. Now these factors are so many, I'm not going to pick up all that, but I'll just run through you quickly what are these factors and very, like they definitely prevail. Like these are factors which are associated with the healthcare professionals itself, factors associated with the work environment, factors associated with the patients itself, factors associated with the medicines, factors associated with the tasks, factors associated with computerized information system, and there are some primary or secondary care interfaces which are there. There is a changeover from suddenly primary to secondary care. So in that, in all these conditions, all these factors, some or the other where influence or affect the people in the healthcare system, all kinds of people who are involved. So lack of therapeutic training, lack of knowledge, then overworkload, fatigue, physical, emotional health issues, everybody. After all, like we are humans and every human, be it in any position, can actually lead to these type of errors. Then factors associated work environment, again, time pressure, distractions, already have discussed with very less resources. So only one person is very much, you know, burdened with. Then apart from this, factors with the patient itself, the kind of patient it is, there will be some cooperative patients, there can be some non-cooperative patients who would be actually, you know, it will depend on patients as well, like how the patient is getting affected, how much attention he himself is paying on his medication. It may so happen that everybody is correct and right from the manufacturing aspects, right? From the clinical trials I'm talking about, from that point onwards, right? From doctor prescribing it correctly, the pharmacist dispensing it rightly, patient as nurses administering it correctly, but the patient has got discharged and taking medication at home. He makes himself the mistakes and doesn't understand it properly. Then error times lead to medication errors. So from the abbreviation units itself, you can make out, like if the units are in the international units, the microgram, even sometimes the terminology OD, that abbreviation, then SC, TIW, IU, HS, it may be misunderstood. So they mean something, but if it is... Hello, Ayush?
Yes, ma'am.
Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
So these can be misinterpreted and there can be so many errors. Ayush, period of O can be interpreted and sometimes it looks as if it is QID.
Something went wrong. Please try again.
Hello, Ayush. जो वहां से कोई नहीं दे रहा है. हेलो आयुष. नहीं अनम्यूट प्लीज.
यस मैम.
Now am I allowed?
Yes, ma'am.
Hello, Ayush.
Yes, ma'am.
see that can be mistaken, and then it can lead to medication errors. Next, Ayush. Next slide. Quickly run through. There are not many slides remaining, only few of them. So this can be done by legible, actually writing in blocks. Then a verbal order should not be given by the doctor. A very detailed patient history. If we as well, and then computerized physician order entry system, that is one of the very modernized computer system like which is started in few of the corporate hospitals in India, but not yet gained much of a popularity in many of the hospitals. So it's still time to come and arrive at that. Next slide, please. Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
Hello.
Yes, ma'am, you are audible.
Okay, so the screen, if you look into that, it gives almost all possible correct details. Computer itself will be having inbuilt warning systems wherein any entry, if at all wrong or not, it won't accept or will give the pop-outs in the form of warnings, and then that can save so many medication errors. Next. Yeah, the same way. And here there are alert section itself, like patient monitoring, electronic surveillance systems, reminders and alerts, wherein like right from the beginning itself, when the patient has been diagnosed with very dangerous condition and is, you know, like being administered some very critically and high alert medications or complex medications, then in the system itself it will be provided or and there will be a self auto generated surveillance system and warnings. So this can also avoid lot many problems and will give a very specific selection of the medications to be administered. Next. So in the medical like if in the delay in dispensing, like dispensing has to be done one-to-one or face-to-face basis, so that all together at one go, if many of the patients are handled by the one, then the chances of errors are very much. So one-to-one basis and with a good proper manpower and a hierarchy, this can be avoided very well. So next, Ayush, next. Next. Hello. Next. Hello. Ayush. Just.
Yes, ma'am.
त्याला आवाजच जात नाही आहे माझा. आयुष.
येस मॅम, यू आर ऑडिबल.
अगला स्लाइड.
वन सेंटेंस इज क्लियर, नेक्स्ट सेंटेंस इज गोइंग, नेक्स्ट सेंटेंस इज क्लियर, नेक्स्ट सेंटेंस गोइंग. असो
Next slide.
नहीं आ रही लाइट आ
नेक्स्ट स्लाइड
हाँ मैडम मैं सेकंड में फोन चेंज करूँ बाबा
माझर आऊँ तुम सर जब चालू के लगता
नहीं है तुम सर आए लेना मैडम ठीक है तुम
आलो तर त्याच्यावर शेअर करायला सांगा तुमच्या याच्या मला माहिती आहे का येत आहे ना तुमच्या याच्यावर दिसत
बोला याला आता मला म्यूट करून ठेवलं तिकडनं
कशाला बसायला पाहिजे
केलं का म्यूट केलं का मला
नाही करत आहे तो मी त्याला सांगते
हॅलो
आयुष जस्ट रन थ्रू द स्लाइड
दादा निरू
हॅलो
येस मॅम
हॅलो
येस मॅम येस मॅम
हा येतो हॅलो प्रस आयुष
येस मॅम
हॅलो
हॅलो बंद
हॅलो
हॅलो आयुष
येस मॅम
यू आर एबल टू हिअर मी
येस मॅम
या so these are few other systems like barcoding and all wherein the nurses when administering they have a small device in the form of a scanner and they like the barcoder what usually is been used in many of the devices she can scan it through it and then she can administer Ayush next slide so this is a barcoding method of verification and this can be also utilized in the wards and the nurses before administration can do scan and then administer the medications next so there are so many transcribing errors wherein like nurses and pharmacists again would not understand the orders what are being written and that can be misinterpreted and then again it will lead to the further errors this is overlapping with what we have already actually discussed so incomplete or illegible prescriber orders incomplete or illegible nurse handwriting use of abbreviations lack of familiarity with the drug names noise in the poor environment can lead to transcribing error and further errors next so like how to minimize these transcribing errors so many like norms have been given wherein like clarify the order before the prescriber leaves the unit so if nurses have any doubt or the senior in charges have any doubt they can actually clarify from the prescriber itself what it means so that makes the job very easy then like contact the prescriber if the order is not eligible if you are having any ambiguity directly you can actually talk to the doctor itself do not process incomplete orders then minimize the use of abbreviations use the leading zero many times the leading zero is quite appreciated so that like it will not lead to some you know where the decimals are required in case of digoxin or narrow therapeutic index drugs it is quite important then do not use the trailing zero many a times the trailing zero if it is misunderstood the point is missed then it may lead to the very very high amount of medication written orders next again we have already seen this next administration errors mainly happen at the end of the nurses when they are about to administer to the patient. So it can happen to like due to discrepancy between the drug received by the patient and the drug therapy intended by the prescriber, related to nursing staff usually, omission or commission errors, wrong drug, wrong dose, duration, frequency, route, the wrong patient. Many a times we you all or myself, we have seen this, that if you've seen in any of the wards, nurses carrying one single tray, but in that there are different types of medications, liquid medications or dosages which are there, like the tablets or capsules and all, they belong to various different patients, but she's carrying in the same train. But it can also happen that she's going to whichever patient, though she must be recognizing them, it is quite likelihood of that, like giving the other patient's medication to some different kind of a patient. Or maybe like nurse who's on a duty and shift has done, she's used to giving to the first bed or a second bed. Like sometimes the patient may be shifted to some other ward or step down therapy. Then some other new patient would, if she fails to recognize that patient, then quite likelihood of wrong administrations are there in such circumstances. Ayush, next. So all these may be also the reason, like workload, then noises, interruptions, distractions, lack of knowledge, inadequate training, unawareness, all these type of parameters actually lead to this type of errors. Next. Checking the patient's identity, ensuring the prescription, minimizing interruptions and maintaining separate trays, recognizing the lesser type of medications, this can avoid the errors happening and reaching the harm to the patient. Next. Again, like the way, like we had seen that the orders actually the can be, you know, like there can be a surveillance orders which can be actually electronically fed. Even the prescription the doctors can feed at their end. Still, like it is happening in many parts, and many parts are still not. Similarly, when there is an administration process, in that process also there can be an administrative. Like a computerized system, wherein if you got to see, like there are many of the drugs which are given at a very less frequency, that is once in a week or once in 3 days, and there is a washout period. And there are like maximum drugs which are given on a daily basis. If such alerts are put in the electronic system itself, and when the nurses check these orders, then it is quite likelihood of lowering down or reducing the administrative related orders. Next. There are monitoring errors, like many a times, like patients when it is discharged and he's given the medications, like there is a combination of medication, there is a shift or there is a change of medications from what he was having in the hospital to the house. And then if there is no proper education, awareness or monitor information given to the patient, then quite likelihood of patient taking wrong way the medications, and then again there will be failure in the treatment. Next. So there are many drugs wherein the TDM is required, where there an INR, like whatever changes are need to be monitored, electrolytes are needed to be monitored. Like even for the diabetic patient, the hyperglycemic levels are to be monitored. There are combination of many a times two or three antihypertensives. Chances of the blood pressure going high up and down is quite likelihood. So those need to be monitored very well, regularly by the patient, even when he was there in the hospital and when he has gone home. So monitoring parameters, if not done properly, then it would not, you know, catch up, and then it would not give us any alert that something is wrong, some changes are required, or something needs to be prevented. Then the harm keeps on continuing, and there is a safety issue. Next. So patient always has to be at the top priority as far as the safety is concerned. Close monitoring is definitely required. Patient needs to be educated when he is discharged, and like a feedback has to be taken, and a proper follow-up. All the history again has to be taken from the patient, like related to all his parameters. Next. In international scenario, there are so many agencies like the National Coordinating Council, Medication Error Reporting and Prevention Agency, which is in America, and there are so many members of developed nations associated with that. And this shows that, like, even FDA, they have a completely very safe regular monitoring of even medication error. Like, in pharmacovigilance is very well developed in these nations. In our India, like, it has started, and there are definitely, like, Indian pharmacovigilance centers are there, peripheral, regional, and a central, this thing. But then it has not reached to each and every tertiary care or a specialty hospitals, wherein on a regular basis, the pharmacovigilance is reported. So there itself, in the very big scenario of pharmacovigilance, we are lacking. So medication error is very, very yet, you know, you can't even call it in an infancy stage, but people don't have much of an awareness of reporting such. But slowly, just because of NAPH accreditation, IGCR accreditations, many of the hospitals that have adopted, and clinical pharmacists, because of the new course of this PharmD, which has come to our country, and people are recognizing now what is happening because of this, like all the clinical pharmacists, they're involved in this quality assurance and quality checks. And definitely they are the ones who are very, very efficiently actually reporting this and started to do this. And that is avoiding a lot of, or decreasing or reducing so many ADRs related to, due to these mishaps. So this is already happening at this level, and it will slowly, definitely, we hope to grow further on this. So in other countries, if you go to see, apart from pharmacovigilance safety data collection and vigilance, there is something called as a patient safety aspect at a even hospital level and individual basis. So that is the difference between them and us, wherein we really need to be reaching to the patient level to take care and see to it that they are very, very safe and no errors or ADRs occur to them. Next. So detecting medication error practice, the methods most commonly used are the incident report review, patient chart review, direct observation, interventions by the pharmacist, ADR, ADE trigger tools. So all these need to be in place, and all everybody should be trained on this so that they can utilize this properly. Next. So at the end of the session, with so many hassles, so many clutches today, sorry for that, but I would say that, like, definitely, to summarize, with medication errors are very, very critical and important. They needed to be identified, they needed to be interpreted, analyzed well in time, not to be allowed to reach to the patient, and reported very well. So this will help the utmost safety of our patient, definitely, to err as a human, but to protect the patient from all these harmful effects of medication is human, rather. So we should be always keeping this mind and working from that point of view. Thank you very much with this, and I end up my session. If anybody has any of the questions, they can put in the chat box. I'm sorry for the technical hitch once again, and I'll try to reply as far as possible. Thank you, and I'll share your scores as well, though I had prepared one more post session now, but it is a little difficult for me to share from the mobile because that is on the desktop and lights are still not come up. So I'll be sharing it later maybe, and the coordinating team will take care of it. And thank you very much. Thank you.
Session is open for questions, sir. If anybody having any questions, either you can post it in the chat box or unmute and you can ask directly to madam. I think there is no question from the participant. Thank you so much, Sunita Pawar ma'am. Medication error is very common, and errors which commonly occurs are transcription errors, administration error, monitoring errors. And madam has explained the causes of medication error, like look like, sound like drugs. Ma'am also explained the various type of categories of medication errors and the various strategies to avoid the medication error. Thank you so much for ma'am, time for taking out for accepting our invitation. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for your kind words and enlightening us with such a valuable information. Now we'll have a small break and meet you all again by 3:40. Thank you, everyone.